What did we do so far in session 1 or 2? We discussed how the kernel of Christian faith on revelation. We discussed the dialogical nature. Then we discussed love as the leading idea of the Christian narrative, which we both interrupted through counterexamples, but also by the idea of love itself. So love is not only what leads our narrative, but is also that what interrupts our narrative when it tends to close. Why? Because God interrupts it. Where does that lead us now? Well, this leads us to the third session, where we will recontextualize school identity, Catholic school. And as we did with the first session, we go back to the Second Vatican Council to start. So this is the outline for this session. So Vatican II, a lasting hallmark for Catholic education, and then we will discuss a little bit the documents and the way in which it functions in Vatican II. And in the second section, we will then recontextualize what we learned from Vatican II in the 21st century, the context of today, using the dialogical impetus of recontextualization, the impetus which we inherited from Revelation, using the interruptive love we discovered in our dialogue with Lieven, in order then to develop the idea that Catholic schools are schools of dialogue in love. Okay. And then the third point is the Catholic Dialogue School. I don't know whether we will have time, but that's, you could say, the application of 1 and 2 in the concrete context in which I am in Flanders. So how are we conceiving the Catholic Dialogue School, and how do we make it both contextually plausible? How can it speak to our context? As well as how can we legitimize it? Can we found it from within the strength of the Christian tradition? Okay. Gravissimum Educationis, you know the document? You ever have read it? It's not a long document either, so if you have some spare time, read Dei Verbum and Gravissimum Educationis, okay? 1965, most of the documents of Vatican II have been promulgated, is the official word, by Pope Paul VI at the end of Vatican II. The issue of education was not a big issue at Vatican II. Not in the preparatory period. Of course, some bishops sent to Rome vota, that were wishes, vota, what to discuss on the council. And there was a preparatory document on it, that's true. But also at the council itself, education was not that much an item. The last document of the Magisterium Education was a document of Pius XI in 1929, Divini Ilius Magistri, which was a document in the atmosphere of the time, which was quite defensive, because Catholic schools and the Catholic school system came under pressure, for instance, through communism and communist influences, also in Western politics. And so the Pope thought that it was necessary to defend the right of parents to choose the school for their children, and also to defend the right of the church to found schools. Now in France, for instance, was not obvious with secularism. Also in Belgium, but then some decades before, there was a real school war. The liberals wanting to control the school system from the state, and then the church fighting that, and so on. And also in other countries, there were some difficulties. So, but that are the two rights, and it's quite defensive. It was also using the concept of subsidiarity. So the state cannot do everything. The state should allow room for the church to erect schools. And at the council itself, the discussion was then, yeah, do we need a separate document? The preparatory document was a repetition of Pius XI. Some thought, maybe we only need a paragraph in Gaudium et Spes on education. We don't need a separate document. There was not much discussion, affection, nor enthusiasm. Joseph Ratzinger writes in his notes, and he calls it a minor document, Gravissimum Educationem. It's a weak, a rather weak document, he writes. Well, one of my predecessors, Bishop Dam, who turned out to be the Bishop of Antwerp a little bit later, he was the secretary of the commission of Gravissimum Educationem, so I don't think he was very pleased with Ratzinger saying that his document was rather a weak document. Okay, good. A lot of people and also commentators on the council would say that the 1977 document, the Catholic School of the Congregation for Catholic Education, that is the real fruit of the Second Vatican Council to education. And of course it definitely will be a fruit, but does that mean that Gravissimum Educationis is a minor document? And as a matter of fact, I think this is too harsh a verdict. Because you cannot read Gravissimum Educationis on itself. You have to read it within the framework of the event and the corpus of text, the textual corpus of Vatican II. Gravissimum Educationis also bears witness to Vatican II, to the spirit of it, and to the way in which this spirit has been written down in the documents. So it shares the dynamics of Vatican II. As a matter of fact, it shares in the very, very, very dynamics of it. As we know, the preparatory document of Dei Verbum was not accepted by the bishops. Well, also the preparatory document, De Scholis Catholicis, Catholicis, in Church Latin, was not accepted by the council. Bishop said, no, that's a weak document. We cannot use it. We will have to redraw the document. And you see, it's from De Scholis Catholicis to On Christian Education. So the perspective is broadened in the document. And indeed, if you read the document, it starts with education in general. And only later on, it speaks about the Catholic school. And so where the preparatory document was still a little bit in the spirit of Pius the 11th, defensive, anxious also, don't trust modern society and so on, you see that in the dynamics of Vatican II, Gravissimum Educationis is rather an optimistic document. And it has to be read in connection to the other documents of Vatican II, and to Gaudium et Spes, of course, the document on the relation of the Church with the modern world. Also Apostolicam Actuositatem, that's the document on lay apostles. You know, the 60s is a time where lay people became also teaching staff in schools. Yeah. Which then has to do with Lumen Gentium. Lumen Gentium, a document on the Church and on the place of the laity in the Church. It has also to be read, of course, in the context of Dei Verbum and other dialogical documents of Vatican II. Because it's about the Church in relation to the world, education. So it also has to do with the document on ecumenism, document Nostra Aetate on other religions, the document on religious freedom, the Dignitatis Humanae, and so on and so on and so on. All these documents, in one way or another, constitute a context in which to read Gravissimum Educationis. And from all these documents, becomes clear that there is a strong connection between how the Church thinks of itself and the way it thinks of its relationship to the world. That has, of course, to do with the dialogical nature. So it's not so that the Church first thinks of itself and then goes in dialogue, but you see that in all these documents, the Church and the way in which the Church thinks of itself is nurtured through the dialogue with the world, with the other, and so on. And that's something, if you read the documents in Vatican II, which you can see not in all documents as clear, but therefore, Ressourcement and Aggiornamento, these two kernel terms, which I used already to talk about Dei Verbum, come back here again as the dynamics of Vatican II. And so hermeneutics, a way of dealing with gravissimum educationes, cannot be done without taking the whole council, the hermeneutics of the whole council, as event and corpus to heart. If you then look at the declaration itself, it starts from this world, it starts from education. And education has to do with, well, first of all, it's the right of every human being. Of course, we know UNESCO and so has said that as well. But as we know today, it's still something to be realized, as there is child labor, for instance, in India and so on. We know education as a right for every child has not yet been realized. It has to do with the whole of the human person. It's about all education, according to the Church, has to do with the whole human person, not only Christian education, all freedom and responsibility. And formation of the whole human person includes becoming a true member of the community and of society. Yeah, that's what the Declaration says about education. What is Christian education then? What is the Catholic school? Well, they realize the ends, the general ends of education, so they are education, and introduce into the Christian faith and community. And they enable, and I quote from Gravissimum Educationis, enabling Christians aware of their calling to learn not only how to bear witness to the hope that is in them, but also how to help in the Christian formation of the world that takes place when natural powers viewed in the full consideration of man, redeemed by Christ, contribute to the good of the whole society. You see that the language of the Second Vatican Council is not immediately our language. We would state this differently today. But what they said there is that Catholic education, Christian education, has to do with the good of the whole society. And how does it contribute to the good of the whole society? By reading, by pointing to what happens in the world from the perspective of God, from the perspective of salvation. It's bringing salvation history and world history together, reading one in light of the other. As a matter of fact, we will read a little bit later that Gaudium et Spes, it says, reading the signs of the times in light of the gospel. So it's not, there is no separation between church and world, no separation between salvation history and history, no. They are intimately connected. It's reading one in terms of the other. And education is not only about saving the souls of children. No, it has to do with formation of human beings to live in this world, to contribute to the good of this world. And Christian education contributes to that by making evident the link of what we do in this world with that salvific perspective. Looking, say it another way, looking at the world with the eyes of God's love, from the perspective of God's salvation, God's love. And we know we have to be careful if we do so, because if we use love as an argument, we end up in a master narrative and so on. The Catholic school then is formulated as such, no less than other schools, no less than other schools. So other schools do it as well. Does the Catholic school pursue cultural goals and the human formation of youth, but its proper function is to create for the school community a special atmosphere animated by the gospel spirit of freedom and charity to help youth grow according to the new creatures they were made through baptism as they develop their own personalities. And finally, to order the whole of human culture to the news of salvation so that the knowledge the students gradually acquire of the world, life and man is illumined by faith. You see, it's again the connection of the world with faith. It's not, there is not a world of faith over there and a world there, no, it's connected. And Catholic education and Catholic school is teaching students, pupils, to live in this world from the perspective of faith. Okay. Education from the perspective of this world, showing how education young people furthers, or educating young people furthers the coming of the reign of God. So that by leading an exemplary apostolic life, they become, as it were, a saving leaven in the human community. So Christian education has to do with schooling people to contribute to this world from the perspective of faith. Therefore, education is a true apostolate. And what is an apostolate according to the Second Vatican Council? It's giving testimony to the reign of God, contributing to the humanization of the world in light of the gospel through a praxis of love. So apostolate has to do with love. A praxis of love which contributes to the humanization of the world in light of the gospel, so in light of the vision of the reign of God. And what is apostolate? Well, apostolate has to do with the call to holiness. The call to holiness which is addressed to all people. The call to holiness is not only addressed to the religious. Even in the document of the religious, you see a very delicate way in pointing to the fact that religious in one way or another have to do more, but it's not another call to holiness. It's the same call to holiness which religious and the laity have. But of course, it's lived in another way. And so the one call to holiness which is addressed to all Christians, that's Lumen Gentium number 40 and 41. And what is the distinctive mark of this one call to holiness? It's love, by which we love God above all things and our neighbor because of God. Lumen Gentium 42. And it's of course on this paragraph then that Perfecte Caritatis, which is a document on the religious, but also Apostolicam Actuositatem, the document on the apostolate of the laity, are then based. All apostolate, there's also the apostolate of education, is founded in love and expresses this love. And further elaborates on this love in a reflection on the intrinsic bond between the love of God and the love of neighbor. Number 8 of that very document. Okay, that's Vatican II. Education is an apostolate, also for the laity, and the mark of that apostolate is a praxis of love. But in the meantime, things have changed. Maybe you noticed when I read the definition of the Catholic school that the pre-understanding was that all children were baptized. Maybe you, so through all creatures, the new creatures, they have become through their baptism. So a school from Catholics, for Catholics. Of course, it was Monsignor Dam, who the later Bishop of Antwerp, who held the pen, of course, in Belgium, that were schools from Catholics, for Catholics at that very moment. Also in Ireland, in Poland, and lots of the people who were busy with education had schools from Catholics, for Catholics. Also, there was at the time a big involvement of diocesan priests and religious from various male and female congregations. In the 50s, just before the council, almost all dioceses in Belgium were enlarging their seminaries. Almost all religious congregations were building new buildings, formation houses, and so on, in order to find out that at the end of the 60s, the numbers started to drop. And also in education, lay people came in and took almost all the positions. Today, I think, in the 2,200 schools which Catholic education have, there's hardly hardly any priest of religious still active in real school life, in the sense as a staff member, a principal, or a teacher. If they are still in our school life involved, it's often in the boards. And then it's one or two sisters, 75 and 78 years old, who are in the board. And then you know that, well, within another 10 years, it will be gone. Yeah? So the sisters themselves will be gone. And then, of course, what was also very prominent at the time is still that the right to organize Catholic education. We had in Belgium a school war between 1950-58, which was also, as these people were also making up the document, which is also felt in the discussion. At the same time, you see at the council that the consciousness of the complexity of worldwide Catholic education, that it started to grow. That's also the reason why, for instance, in Gravissimum Educationis, in the introduction says, we're only going to lay down some major principles. And it's up to the local hierarchy, the bishop conferences, and to the religious congregation, to see how these principles work in their contexts. Because we have many different contexts. And of course, that's a consciousness which we today have much more. We thought, because of the fact that we had Muslims in our schools, that we had a problem. But you know, there are Catholic schools in Algeria where there is only one Christian in those schools. And that's the Archbishop being the head of the board of the schools. All the others, principals, directors, parents, children, are all Muslims. And nobody is doubting the fact that they are Catholic schools. The Sophia University in Japan is a Jesuit university. Nobody is doubting that it is a Jesuit university. But there are hardly Christians. Almost everybody there, staff, students and so on, is either Shinto or Buddhist. But nobody is doubting that it is a Catholic school. In Kerala, we have many, many Catholic schools, most often sponsored by the Siru Malabar Church, which is an Eastern Rite connected to the Roman Catholic Church. In a lot of these schools, Catholics only constitute 20%, and all the others are Hindus or Sikhs or whatever. So in a way, the comparative lesson and the fact to become conscious of the complexity of worldwide Catholic education shows us that our situation might be the exception, in a way. And it does not depend on the amount of Christians you have in your school, whether they are Catholic or not. But seemingly there is something else, namely the project. That's what you want to do in school life, which makes it Catholic or not. And that's, especially for Western Europe, this is a lesson to be learned, because in Catholic education, Western Europe has survived quite well. You have seen the figures. If 3 out of 4 in secondary education go to a Catholic school in Flanders, it's because people think we offer quality education. But we do, of course. I never would say the opposite. But then the question is, and that's a question both asked in the church, but also by society. But what is Catholic about these schools? Because people send their children because it's quality education. They don't send them because it's Catholic. And then you have these figures. 33% sends their children because the school is closest to their home. 50% sends their children because it's quality education. Only 3% sends them because it's Catholic. So why would we call them Catholic? Only 3% wants it. And then questions start. What makes them Catholic? And if we point to that question from the Second Vatican Council, the text of Gravissimum Educationis, then the question reads as follows: do Catholic schools still contribute to the fulfillment of the mission of the people of God and to the fostering of the dialogue between the church and mankind to the benefit of both. It's not by accident that I quote this, because you see, to the dialogue between the church and mankind. The dialogue here is again very much present. Do Catholic schools still contribute to that? And how do they do that under the present circumstances? Let's do some recontextualization now. We have these documents in relation to the other documents of Vatican II. We know that it is an apostolate of love, education, and we know that it has to do with education in general and so on. So the argument we're going to engage in has three steps. We're going back, and it's in a way a rehearsal of the first two sessions. Dialogue as God's way to relate to humanity, the foundation, then the dialogical interruptive dynamics of love, as how to conceive of that dialogue in love today, and then education as an apostolate of love and holiness. Okay, so the first two parts I will treat a little bit more rapidly, because we have seen them in the first session and the second session, but it might be a good reminder to what we have done. As I started with this morning, both the Council itself as well as the reception of the Council have been framed from the question, in what way dialogue is at the core of Christian revelation and tradition. And Dei Verbum has then redefined revelation as the salvific event of God's self-revelation as love in Jesus Christ and the Spirit. And that very fact, that it is about the salvific event, and that revelation, scripture, tradition, theology, and the magisterium stand in relation to that event, that's the reason why revelation, scripture, tradition, theology, and the magisterium have a historical and a dialogical character. Because it's fundamentally about the dialogue of God with humanity, which we can retrieve from our daily dialogues, the dialogue with the sources, the dialogue with others, the dialogue with the world. And dialogue then is the drive of tradition development. Ressourcement, dialogue with the sources, and aggiornamento, dialogue with the world of today. I pointed also at the 50 years of reception and discussion, the discussion on the dialogue. Is dialogue leading to adaptation? Or is dialogue really leading to a renewal of Christian identity? And that's a discussion which can be very practical. I will give you an example. You know, lots of our little children, when they are initiated for the First Communion, they don't know what the Eucharist is, isn't it? And you know, the Eucharist is not so easy to understand. Some of the priests, they would adapt, therefore, a little bit of the Eucharist to the world of the children in order to make it more understandable. So they dialogue with the world of children in order to make the Eucharist a little bit more understandable. So for instance, the biblical text will be retold. It can be bibliodrama or... But of course, some of these biblical texts stand very far from the world of children. So why would we still use a biblical text? Could we not better use a story which speaks more to the world of children? And you see, there is a kind of sliding in this dialogue, and it's sometimes very difficult to pinpoint down your finger where it happens, where you see that dialogue becomes adaptation, and that the particularity of the Christian tradition, what it is really about, that you lose it. At the same time, you could have a priest saying they want to learn about the Eucharist. The Eucharist is what they are going to get. Not any dialogue with the world of children. We just do the Eucharist as it should be done, and they will receive First Communion. Final. Because the fact that they don't understand it is not a problem. because it is not about the world of children, it's about the world of God. And they have to be integrated in the world of God. You see, continuity, discontinuity, two ways of dealing with it, two ways of... And is dialogue then leading to adaptation? Or would the dialogue with the world of children, could it also lead to a renewal of liturgy, respecting the very particularity of liturgy? And that's the discussion about dialogue. And there are the theological approaches which I pointed at between correlation and anti-correlation, continuity and discontinuity. That's that whole discussion. And of course, that whole if there are no biblical texts anymore in your liturgy, if you take from the hindsight, you could say, yeah, indeed, we have lost our particularity. But sometimes it's done with the best intentions, of course. It's to translate, to make the faith understandable. But in making the faith understandable, you lose the faith. The discontinuity approach can lead to the same thing. Because of the alienation, you say, well, the fact that they don't understand the faith, that's not an accident, because they can't. So let's just bring it, but the end result is alienation. The end result is that there is no renewal of faith, that there is no transmission of faith, that faith misses the opportunity to renew itself in the process of being transmitted. That dialogical, that recontextualizing element.
Lieven, before you go on from that point, if I may.
Yeah.
Firstly, I find that point you're making about particularity just so very helpful. Why does religion have to be particular, and why is it able to be renewed when it's not particular? When you take generalizing, modernizing, universalizing approaches, why is that so damaging?
I will give you the example of which I gave the specific partner relationship. Love is not lived out there. It's lived in concrete relationships. And of course, you can recognize a lot of the love you experience yourself in other experiences of people. But you never will be able to exchange. The love relationship you have with your partner has a particularity, a unicity, a singularity, which makes it so specific that it is not exchangeable. You can recognize a lot of it, and it will, to the depth, color the way in which you think about love. But you cannot do away with it. That very particularity makes you who you are. And that's the same with the Christian tradition. In one way or another, the particularity of the Christian tradition and the way it is lived in your own context, that is the Christian tradition for you. And you cannot just exchange that for other things. Yeah. And that's always the problem when people start saying, well, we're not going to use this from the Christian tradition because that and that. Instead of thinking, yeah, but how could we recontextualize it? How could we make it speak to people, even if it does not speak to people at first sight? Yeah? Sometimes the confrontation, the interruption, which the particularity of the Christian tradition can bring, can be fruitful as well. Of course, when it leads to discontinuity, it's really a balance between continuity and discontinuity. Interruption, when interruption leads to rupture, you haven't won anything. Yeah. When there is no interruption, there's only continuity. But that's a luxury we don't have in our context, because there is too much interruption most often. Precisely because of the context in which we live. Anyway, what we should not forget is the call of Gaudium et Spes to read, and it's very important to read the whole quote, because often we only read the first sentence, to read the signs of the times, interpreting them in light of the gospel, so that it can offer, in a manner appropriate to each generation, replies to the continual human questionings on the meaning of this life and the life to come, and how they are related. Right, that's what Gaudium et Spes said. That's our job. The church, and people in the church, Christians, should read the signs of the times, what happened today, the refugee crisis, for instance, interpreting them in light of the gospel so that it can offer in a manner appropriate to each generation, each, that's also ours, replies to the continual human questionings on the meaning of this life and the life to come and how they are related. Have you ever heard about hermeneutical intersections? That's this, okay? That's this. That's a concrete application of this. That's reading the signs of the times in light of the gospel. What is hermeneutical? It's an interruption, in a way. It's interrupting your normal way of doing, because it is interrupted, it's a felt interruption, in order to reflect, in order to go back to the sources, for instance, in order to bring in some more material, in order to enrich yourself, in order to question, to reflect, to... So indeed, how then to understand dialogue? Well, we know it by now, eh? Beyond continuity and discontinuity, dialogue, to be sensitive for the interruptions. We gained it from the dialogue with postmodern thinkers, God Interrupts History. And this brings us not to Christianity as a master narrative, but as an open narrative. a narrative which fosters a sensibility to be interrupted, not to become a hegemonic narrative. So a narrative which is conscious of the fact that if it does not let itself be interrupted, it will become a master narrative. There's a master narrative, for instance, which is conscious of the fact that too easy forgiveness is no forgiveness. That too easy love, love which covers up, doesn't lead in the end to the opposite of love, and so on. Which immediately brings us to the second point, which is a little bit of a rehearsal of the second session. When then thinking about love, we should indeed be conscious of the fact that Christianity can be a closed master narrative, as Jean-François Lyotard has tried to show us. By loving from the outset what is going to happen, one encloses whatever there is to happen in one's narrative. Everything is already within that horizon of love. Nothing can escape it. Everything is already known. Love all too easily encapsulates otherness and difference. In a master narrative of love, there is no interruption. Love has become a part of an argument and is no longer an event, something happening, something which interrupts the argument. Engaging this criticism of Lyotard, first of all, makes us then aware of the fact that we have to be careful, that the Christian faith can become such a narrative. So this engaging this criticism interrupts our theologies of love. But we also know that this first interruption of our theologies of love may point us to the second interruption, that the interruption of our theologies of love, that they precisely happen by love. And this interruptive power of love is a reading key to read our Christian tradition. And maybe you saw in the last session that I went over some biblical passages too soon. I'm now going to tell you. Let me start with the one on love itself. You know the adulterous woman? Well, you don't know her, of course, but you know the story. You know the story of the adulterous woman. She's brought before Jesus. As a matter of fact, I always have wondered why only the woman was brought before Jesus, because in committing adultery you have to be with two. I always heard. I have no experience with it. I don't know, but I thought you had to be with two. This is a comment we make, eh? This is our interruption of that narrative. There have been times in history people never would have made that comment. It's our context and our gendered our gender consciousness, which makes us make this comment. Yeah? That's an interruption of the biblical narrative. Okay, that's entre parenthèses here, we put it over there. But that woman is brought before Jesus. And with a clear intention, they want to trap Jesus, because Jesus pleads, Jesus proclaims a love of God, but that a love of God, a God of love, but that same God has written in the law, in Deuteronomy, whenever you catch a woman in adultery, you stone her. Okay, so what does he have to do now? Either he says, you stone her, okay, let's stone her, and I will throw the first stone. Yeah, where is his God of love then? Or he says, no, you cannot stone her because God is love, but then that's blasphemy, because in the law is you have to stone her, and it's God's law, you know, because Moses written it down. So he was trapped. But then he was quite a smart guy, I think, because he starts to write in the sand, and he says, well, whoever is without sin can throw the first stone. Yeah, and they go away, the eldest first, I don't know why, but yeah. Oh. And then after a while he says to the woman, okay, they all have gone. Yes, yes. But also, I will not condemn you. And he says, go and do not sin no more. He didn't say, go and finish what you're busy with, but just, what is happening here? At three instances, closing and closed narratives are interrupted and broken open. First, a narrative of entrapment. You cannot play out the God of love against the God of the law. If the law doesn't serve the God of love, then the law is not the law. The law stands. The law is there in order to show what a God of love is and not the opposite. So the law cannot be played out against God's love. First. Second, the scribes and the Pharisees were dethroned. They who thought that they could use the law as an argument to condemn the woman and to entrap Jesus, they were dethroned and put under the law themselves. Whoever is without sin, I know, but they found out that they were not without sin, so that they were under the law rather than the masters of the law sitting on the chair of Moses to judge people. Thirdly, the woman was an object of a juridical dispute. They didn't ask to the woman, do you want to be stoned in order for her? No, she was an object. What Jesus does is making her the subject again of the narrative. He speaks to her. He asks her, where did they go? Where have they gone? And then breaks open her narrative of sin, because he isn't saying, go and finish what you're busy with, but go and sin no more. So you see, the conclusion of the whole is that precisely in the breaking open of all these narratives, the God of love is revealed. That's the way how the God of love reveals God's self, in breaking open the narratives, both the narratives of those who use God's discourse, God's law, in order to condemn others, but also the narrative of the victim, the narrative of the object of the dispute, who was made again the subject of her own narrative. But there are also other little stories. The one of the Samaritan, you know, that's a breaking open at several instances of closed stories. Let's start with the question. It's a man asking, what do I have to do to earn the kingdom of God? And Jesus says, well, you know what there is in the law. Indeed, Deuteronomy again, love God and love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, but who is my neighbor? and then the story starts. And then, you know, there was somebody robbed and so on. And then the priest passes by, the Levite, and then it's a Samaritan helping out. That must have been an awful thing for the Jews to hear. Because they're the religious narrative of the time was interrupted at several instances. First of all, the priest and the Levite, they hardly could help. Because if they would help, they would not be able to function in the cult at the temple in Jerusalem. They could not serve God if they would have helped, because they would have made themselves impure by touching the blood of the one who was robbed. Because blood was making impure. So it was for religious reasons they could not help. So Jesus is putting the whole worldview, religious worldview, at its head. Because the Samaritan, who was not even considered a good Jew, the Samaritan, that is the day for the Jews, that is the one who shows what real religion is. That God's loving God is precisely channeled by loving the neighbor. So the priest and the Levite, who out of love for God could not help the neighbor, and that story is interrupted in order for the Samaritan, who was not even conceived as a good Jew, to do the right thing. But the tricky thing, of course, is in the end of the story, where Jesus asks, he doesn't ask who is the neighbor, but who has become the neighbor of the man fallen victim to the robbers. So neighborship and law of neighbor has nothing to do with the question who is my neighbor, but has especially to do with to whom do I become the neighbor. So you see, it's not me looking for somebody as my neighbor, it's the other to whom I become the neighbor. So it doesn't start from me, it starts from the other. And then, yeah, my favorite, the prodigal son. That's a fantastic story, isn't it? You have heard it so many times, I must think, because we always have been, yeah, we always have been told this story. And I don't know about you, but when we heard it, our identification person most often was the youngest son. We identified with the youngest son. And you can do it, it's a fantastic story, because it means, well, it doesn't matter what you do, you can do wrong, there will be forgiveness, isn't it? God will receive you with open arms. And it's a pity that the eldest son cannot understand it, but at least we will be in order, God will receive us again. Of course, Jesus didn't tell it to people who identified them with the youngest son. And as a matter of fact, I don't think neither one of us should identify with the youngest son. We are the eldest son. We are the good Catholics. At least we try to be the good Catholics. We are the ones who would say to the father, but we have tried our best, you know. We are teachers in Catholic schools. We have worked for Catholic education. But the others there, they have done wrong all the day. They haven't even tried to do their best, what we do all the time. And they are received. You even killed you even slaughtered the calf in order to, and I haven't even got a little goat. You see, it's a little bit the experience of Jesus with the Syrophoenician woman. So it's what is God's love? And does God's love answer to our ways of thinking what just love is? And of course, it's very hard. It's hard to understand. It's not hard to understand the difficulties the eldest son experiences at that moment, because that are our difficulties. Of course, I think we can also identify with the father and the youngest son at times. But I think our position in principle is the one of the eldest son, the ones interrupted in the way in which they think God's love should function. What real Catholic faith is, what forgiveness is, what love for our children is in schools, what Catholic education is, what the church should do, and so on. God interrupts and keeps open the horizon of love. And even when everything goes wrong, even when Jesus dies on the cross, even then there is interruption, because that's the final message of Christianity. That the story which was closed on the cross, that God has opened it. That finally, the horizon of love will open even stories of death. So the first interruption of our theologies of love may point us to a second interruption, the interruption of our theologies by love. This interruptive love then becomes a way to try to understand how God relates to history, but also a way to interrupt all such understanding, because the moment we think we understand it and we use it as an argument, at that very moment God might interrupt our understanding. And that's, I think, the contextual theological opportunity of our days. That is perceiving of God's relationship to us, to human history, in terms of this interruptive love. There have been other ways to think about God's love. In the times of Augustine, a little bit Thomas Aquinas, but especially Augustine, the relationship between God's love and our love was seen as a relationship of participation. Our love participated in God's love. And of course, philosophically speaking, that was indeed the way to do it at that moment. But time and again, recontextualization is looking for philosophical schemes, for arguments, for ways of thinking, which try to see that relationship between God and humanity in contextually plausible, in ways with which we can do something in our context, with which we are challenged. And I think that interruption could be such a way today, and that our dialogue with the current context makes us extra sensitive for that. Just to tell you, somebody did a doctorate on the Syrophoenician woman. You should know how many people in the history of theology have tried to undo that story of its interruptive character, because it could not be true that Jesus had to learn about God's love. That cannot be true. He must have had a bad night before. He must have been busy with other things. That could not be that Jesus had to learn. So you see, the interruptive power is so devastating for certain ways to conceive of Jesus, two secure ways to conceive of Jesus, that the sensibility today for us it's much easier to go along with that, because there are also experiences in our own life in which we are interrupted in the way in which we think about things. And if you see interruption as a reading key for scripture, you see even how it is operative over there. And precisely because we are interrupted, we in one way or another have been able to discover the fact that being interrupted might not be such a bad thing, but that it helps us to understand how Christian faith could be lived today, and how Christianity in one way or another could function in a context which has changed dramatically. Okay, let's now apply this to education. Where are we now? Let's go back to Vatican II. The call to holiness is addressed to all faithful, and the distinctive mark of holiness is love. As an apostolate, education is an apostolic work of love. Are you with me on this point? Okay, good. Second point. Reconsidering the apostolate of education is a continual task to be framed within the broader dynamics of recontextualization which characterizes all tradition development. Okay? Good. But if that is not okay, I should start all over because that was the very point I made in the beginning, isn't it? Yeah. Third point. Such theological recontextualization is assisted by wagering on the dialogical interruptive dynamics of love as a theological mode of thinking to relate God to world and history and the Christian faith to the current culture and society. And on the basis of these three steps now, we're going to recontextualize the Catholic school as a school of dialogue in love. And I will do so by pointing to two double interruptions. Two contextual ones, so the context interrupting, or Catholic school interrupting the context, but also two theological ones. Theological always has to do, where does God reveal Godself? Eh? Theological have to do with God, contextual have to do with the relationship between school and world. Okay? School and God, school and world. Okay? Good. Let's go into the contextual ones. There is a double contextual interruption, a contextual interruption of the Catholic school by the context, but also one of the context by the Catholic school. So the interruption of the Catholic school of old is the first interruption. Our Catholic schools are interrupted. Detraditionalization, pluralization, we cannot go on as we used to. We know if we don't do anything that our schools will silently secularize, isn't it? The Apologet can show this with the figures that if you don't do anything, we silently will secularize. Okay. So our self-understanding is interrupted. The Catholic school of old, a school from Catholics, for Catholics, whatever we want, whatever our hierarchy would want, and so on. But that's not the way as it is today. And even if we would want such a school again, it's hardly feasible. In Belgium, for instance, we cannot even discriminate at the front door. So we cannot allow make a distinction between baptized children and non-baptized. Imagine that we have 100 places for 200, and there would be 100 baptized. We would not be able to select the 100 baptized in Belgium. So here you can, we wouldn't be able to do that. Yeah. Because if we would do that, they would go to court and say, well, but you're sponsored your schools, so we have to allow everybody. Okay, good. So this means this is a situation. Deal with it. Pluralization has happened. Detraditionalization has happened. Deal with it. That's the contextual interruption of the Catholic school. Yes, for the people who are yesterday, contextual interruption of the Catholic school is most visible. Church practice in the younger generation, less than 1%. Okay? 75% of them are in your school. Deal with it. But there is, on the contextual level, the Catholic school also interrupts the context itself. Because there is a common assumption in our society that our society is on its way to be completely secularized. That Catholic schools, in the end, that they won't matter anymore. So at every time that then the Catholic school is there and says it is Catholic, that confronts society with the question, how is that possible? Why would there be people saying that we are in need of Catholic schools? Why would it matter? Is education not neutral? Does it really matter which anthropology which is behind your project? So the Catholic school, by its mere existence, and by the fact that it wants to recontextualize itself, already interrupts the context, because the context expects that it will secularize. Yes, the people who were yesterday there, I told you about my recent experiences with politics and the media in Belgium, where the Catholic dialogue school was bashed in a way. It was as if it was profiled in the media, as if we would build on every, in every school garden a mosque, as if we would Islamize Catholic education. The only thing we said is that we want to take Muslims seriously in our schools, because we think that the dialogue between the religions offers possibilities also for the Christians to engage anew in their identity. But immediately some of our politicians, right-wing politicians, said Catholic schools will lose their souls because they allow for Muslims in their schools. But we don't have to allow the Muslims in our schools, they are already there. Maybe half of the Muslims in Belgium are already in our schools. But the thing is, does that not offer us a pedagogical opportunity? The fact that there is difference in our schools. Think of the Canaanese woman. Jesus learned a lot in the dialogue. The Syrophoenician learned a lot in the dialogue. We might learn something in the dialogue as well. So, the two contextual interruptions point to the pedagogical agenda of how to construct one's identity in a context in which identity is no longer pre-given and stable. Both for the school, but also for society, identity is no longer pre-given. Catholic identity isn't, but also other identities aren't. And then secondly, the Catholic school's own particular identity and foster the idea that identity and plurality are not contradictory to each other, but dynamically related. So the two contextual interruptions of and by the Catholic school points us to do these things. Identity has become an assignment, and the Christian way to deal with it can be challenged, but also contribute to that search for identity in a context where many religions, where many positions are available. This double interruption, contextual interruption, instigates a double theological interruption. And the first interruption is again the interruption of school identity. The confrontation with difference and otherness is not only a pedagogical but also a theological opportunity. The Catholic school as the place of God's revelation. The Catholic school as the place where children, but also staff members and parents and the church community, society, may be interrupted by God's love. Yesterday evening I told you the little story about the Christian women who were invited to the breaking of the fast of a Muslim community, Muslim women, where on the day after, one of the Christian women witnessed to that event and said that she learned two things. First of all, she said that when we discussed Lent and Ramadan, in the beginning we thought it's all a little bit the same, you know. Huh? It's eating less, isn't it? She said, we found out that that's not true. It's not all the same. It's very different. Ramadan functions differently in the spirituality of a Muslim than Lent does in a Christian spirituality. A Ramadan is cyclical. Lent is temporal, is linear. Lent leads to something. Lent is in the preparation of Easter. So it's Lent is a preparatory time. It's not a practice in its own right. It's a preparatory practice in view of. So that's another way of dealing with it. Well, that was quite interesting to talk to each other and to learn. And we learned a lot. And we learned to appreciate each other precisely because of the difference. So the difference was not a hindrance to appreciation. No, it's precisely because you could talk about the difference that you really understood each other. But she said, and we started to understand ourselves better precisely because of the dialogue. But she said that was not the most important lesson. The most important lesson came when the Muslim women asked us, after having explained what they did for Ramadan, and what do you do for Lent? And then she said, we were all silent. Yeah, what do we do for Lent? Yeah, eating fish on Friday, but it's hardly Lent, isn't it? Fish is more expensive in Belgium, I think here as well. Then, we give some money for Caritas purposes. But what do we do for Lent? And then, of course, this is the question after recontextualization. How is Lent lived? Now, is that not the point where God reveals God's self in such dialogues, when people are pushed to ask about their own identity, about their the Christian valuable element in that identity? Is that not what happens when dialogue pushes not only to a better understanding and mutual understanding of the other, but also understanding of the self, but also pushes the question of the authenticity? And is that not what could happen in our schools as well, when the dialogue with the other not only is a pedagogical opportunity, but also then becomes a theological one, namely the place where God might reveal God's self? But a Catholic school which allows for the dialogue and is sensitive for where God might reveal God's self is also a school which will interrupt the context. A school which might interrupt the context on God's behalf. A school which might become thus a symbol and sign of God's interruptive love in this world. At that moment, such a school can be a training ground for a society which has difficulty to deal with identity and plurality, with difference and otherness. A school which might interrupt on behalf of God. I have one simple example of that. So we have a lot of refugees, you might have some as well. We have lots of refugees in Belgium, and immediately our schools, and especially at the coast side, they immediately opened up their schools and extra classrooms to receive the refugees. And I must say, this, whereas state schools at that very moment were quite reluctant of doing so. Well, I have found this a speaking token of what it is to start from a Christian anthropology. Okay, you could say it was out of Christian values. It's definitely true. But it's not so. Christian values here, recontextualization there. You know, if you have done the research, there is a... But I think we have got there an opportunity by appealing to what happens there to bring that into a recontextualizing dynamic. Because the intuition which is behind it is an intuition to be... But you cannot think that intuition immediately will lead to a Christian frame of reference. But you can see it as a hermeneutical intersection, isn't it? To bring the Christian tradition again into play at that point. And there you can make a difference. Also on the level of society, Catholic schools can make a difference. It has also to do, for instance, adult education. So we have also Catholic centers of adult education. We see there is an enormous pressure of society to push adult education in a kind of professionalizing dynamics. You get an accreditation to do some work, to do a professional activity. And what we lose in adult education is often the fact that adult education is also education, that it is formation, and that long life learning is not only meant at making people better practitioners, but also helping people to reflect on their own life, to see opportunities, to redirect their lives if possible. But also there, as Catholic education, because of our anthropology, we have to push that point time and again against forces of the labor market who would want to make adult education instrumental to the immediate needs of the labor market. And so then I think, well, indeed, and that are the moments when we have to play out and also the Christian inspiration. Then you have to say it, that it's because of your Christian inspiration that you do so. Because it's not self-evident. The particularity of the Christian tradition has to be brought into the play if you want it to be part of the play. It won't become there, it won't be part of it by itself. Because that's a little bit what the project of the new Catholic, of the Catholic Dialogue School, what we try to do. So we start from the presumption that there is no contradiction between Catholic identity and openness to plurality and otherness. It's not because we make room for Muslims in our school that they are no longer Catholic. No, it's precisely maybe the opposite. In welcoming the other, maybe we are much more Catholic than in excluding the other. And the big thing about the Catholic Dialogue School, and I think that's elementary in the recontextualization project, is that we no longer use the word still. Because still, if you use the word still, you present the past as the norm for the present and the future. And the past we know was schools from Catholics for Catholics. And sorry, that's no longer what we are able to do. And maybe we should not be, maybe it's not even bad that we are no longer able to do so. The Catholic identity of a school does not depend on the amount and presence of Catholics in the school, but on the quality of its project. Linking up for the quest for identity, where dialogue with plurality, difference, and otherness is both a pedagogical and a theological opportunity. And such a school then is in two ways Catholic. First of all, the background vision informing the concept of dialogue. Dialogue is not neutral, is not just exchange, but dialogue is founded in the historical dialogical character of revelation. A Catholic dialogue school is not just dialogical because of the fact that today dialogue is a fashionable word. You know, it's dialogical because God is dialogical. Mutual asymmetries, mutual vulnerabilities. And secondly, the Catholic Dialogue School is Catholic when it is able to bring the Christian voice into the dialogue again as a privileged dialogue partner. And that's an institutional assignment, but also a challenge for contemporary Catholics. And what is the difference between bringing the Christian voice into the Catholic Dialogue School? What is the difference between that and the Christian values education? That is the focus. In Christian values education, the Christian voice intends to link up to everybody, intends to make a consensus for everybody. In a Catholic dialogue school, the Christian voice can speak out of its own particularity. It can challenge people. It's not a consensus from the very beginning. It's a particular voice within the dialogue of voices. But it is a voice which, if we do not have attention for it to bring it in, which won't be there by itself.
Do you mind just making that point again, please?
Yeah. So the Catholic Dialogue School is Catholic because of two reasons. First of all, the anthropology behind it and the theology behind it is dialogical. And that's, of course, because of the fact that revelation. But today, in the dialogue itself, that Christian voice will not be there if we do not bring it consciously in. In Christian values education, we taught that if we stress the values, the Christian background of the values will immediately also be present. Well, in a detraditionalized context, that's no longer the case. It's not because you say solidarity that people understand solidarity as solidarity onto the cross, solidarity as Jesus did it. If we want people to understand how Jesus understands solidarity, we will have to talk about Jesus and the way Jesus understands solidarity. And we will have to compare, we have to make distinctions between that kind of solidarity and other understandings of solidarity which are prevalent in our society. A hermeneutical intersection at that moment is precisely the moment where the concept of solidarity is discussed. And where you are challenged to go back to our own sources to see what Christian solidarity could mean. A Christian solidarity is a radical concept of solidarity. A concept of solidarity which we cannot think radically enough. Because when we think it's for the Jews alone, the dialogue with the Syrophoenician woman will teach us that maybe our concept is too small. So you see, that's the challenge where we stand for. And of course, this is something we will have to learn anew. Because we have learned to be silent. we have learned to be accommodating. We have learned not to speak up. We have learned to speak for everybody. But there must be ways to speak from the particularity of Christian faith as a challenge, as an invitation, within a dialogue, to converse with each other and to come to a maturer faith for the Christians and to more reflexive identities for all those others concerned in our schools. And of course we have to do that in kindergarten, in the way of kindergarten, in primary schools, in the way of primary schools, in secondary schools, in the way secondary schools should do, and in higher education and university, in the way university should do that. Is that enough? Can we have a break now?
Yeah.
Okay.